might as well sit it over. I'll give it over to you and she'll introduce. But we got with us in the house today, y'all, Dr. Tracy Lewis Hardy. I want to give her a hand. Come on, y'all. We need to respect the woman of God who's in the house, all the way from Georgia. And we're getting to know one another. Amen. And I know she has a wonderful spirit. She loves Jesus and she does a mighty work around this nation and even outside in the whole world. Amen. God's using her. And I'll let her tell you some of the things she does. She's got a tremendous book she's written. And I'm just telling you, I can't wait to get it. I'm going to buy one of those books. And I encourage anybody in the back when you leave, you want to get a book, get a book. Amen. It's good, y'all. We need to read. Need to read the Bible and need some other books when you got some men and women of God who love the Lord. Amen. So I'm going to ask her to come forward. She's going to introduce those that are with her. Y'all give the Lord now a big old hand as Dr. Tracy comes forth. Praise God. God bless you, hon. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Love you so much, darling.
God bless you. Now we're going to find out who's really hungry for God. Amen. Well, I'm just blessed to be here this morning. I'm looking forward to what the Lord wants to do. I came to do the will of the Father. Didn't come here for any other reason. And I know the Lord's going to do something mighty in our midst. Amen. The Bible tells us that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb. We know that, right? We overcome by the blood of the Lamb. There's three things that cause us to overcome. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb. We overcome by the word of our testimony, like these men have given this morning. And we overcome by not loving our own lives, even unto death. We don't want to talk about that part. But the Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony, and not loving our own lives, even unto death. And I have two special ladies here with me this morning. If you'll just bear with us for a few minutes, because I believe that they need to overcome by the word of their testimony this morning. And we run a transitional housing for women who are starting their life over from many different walks of life, addiction, prison, homelessness, whatever it is, that God brings them along our path. We do a lot of different things, but I'm not here to talk about those things today. I'm here to give the word of God and to minister to the people of God this morning. And I know that as we fellowship together, God began sending me over here last August, I believe it was, the Spirit of the Lord reconnected me with Sister Wendy. She was one of the first members in my church over 30 years ago. This is my 30th year of ministry. She got saved under my ministry in Michigan. And God reconnected us, but God uses different things to connect us where he wants us to be. And he used that friendship, that relationship that we've had over the last 30 years to bring me to a place where God has a work for me to do. And so when we're obedient to whatever God tells us to do, and we're faithful in it, God will bless us. So at this time, I'm going to ask Jerry to come and just give a brief testimony, whatever God wants to, you want to share. And I just know that you overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. Amen.
Well, God gave me a second chance. A month ago, I was in your shoes. But I press on to what Christ has, you know, promised me. And even though I had a stroke, I know God's working in my life. And I've overcome drugs. With him, you can be overcome. So I'm a bit nervous, as you can tell. But I just believe that with first and second and third chances, how many chances you need? Amen. You can overcome anything with Christ Jesus. Thank you.
Amen. Jerry's celebrating 3 years clean. Amen. 3 years. So I thank the Lord for that. And she's been with us about 2 years, and she's about to get her beautician's license. So wouldn't that be like the devil to try and hit her with a stroke? So you agree with us that in the next, I'm just going to speak it out, in the next 30 days, she is able to use her hand and return back to work and return back to beauty school and get her license. She's 1 month away. And she's going to be a business owner, and she's going to own her own salon. And she's also been certified as a biblical specialty counselor. So she's going to combine counseling with hair. So we know God can do a great thing. Amen. We love you, Jerry. And at this time, another daughter of mine, Renata, is going to come. And she's from Houston. And she's going to give a brief testimony, and she wants to share with you the way God has gifted her. Amen.
Hey, how y'all doing? Good. Well, I've been clean since 2010. Yeah. And, the love that's in this house is so powerful. So powerful. And I don't have kids. And the way y'all was speaking about how you speak life over your kids, see, I'm speaking life over my nephews and my nieces. That's right. Over my family. Because somebody spoke life over me. Which caused God to just reach out and take me out of the depths that I was in. And I'm free from drugs and alcohol. Hallelujah. And the way I speak to God is through dancing, you know. And I just want to share this little dance because we all conquerors. And in the situation that we are in, through Christ and through God, that we can get through anything. Not only by praying, but through our testimony and doing good and doing the next right thing for somebody else. And not being selfish and keeping it to yourself.
We shared our blood.
to God. Because of Christ, we are here today. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you that it's in you we live. It's in you we move. It is in you we have our being. You called our name before the foundations of the world. You chose us to be in you. We thank you, Lord God, that all the people under the sound of my voice today, Father, will hear and will move, Father, where you desire them to move, will do what you desire them to do. Father, I thank you that you open the ears of your people, the hearts of your people, the minds of your people today. Holy Spirit, have your way in our midst today. Cause us to triumph in those things that we are bound in. Cause us to see who you really are in our lives. Father, I thank you right now that you encapsulize your people and you cover them from every thought that would keep them from receiving the word you have placed upon my heart today. I thank you, Father, they are the healed of the Lord. They are the blessed of the Lord. They are the delivered of the Lord, that your word is able to deliver. Your word is able to destroy all the works of the enemy. You are the living word. You are the bread from heaven, and we exalt your name and we magnify you, Jesus, as Lord of all. We glorify you and we thank you that in this day of salvation, you have given us another day to call out on that name. And so we give you praise and we reverence you as King of Kings, as Lord of Lords, as the one who will forever reign, Jesus Christ, the Righteous One. You are worthy of all glory, of all honor, of all praise. You are worthy of all glory, of all the honor, of all the praise. So Lord, hide me. Hide me. Yes, and have your way. Hallelujah. In this house today, Father, as we are overcoming, as we are triumphing in you, the Lamb of glory, we glorify you. We give reverence to your holiness today. Father, we acknowledge that you are the creator of heaven and earth. Yes. You are God. There is none like you. What you have planned as Father, you provided for us by your Son. And we acknowledge you, Jesus, as the Son, the Lamb of God, who take away the sin of the whole world. And we welcome you, Holy Spirit, as the teacher of the church, to lead us and to guide us in what the Father would have us to say today. And we give you praise, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm excited about what the Lord has placed on my heart. I'm just waiting on the Holy Spirit on which direction to go. Are you okay? Are you ready to hear something from heaven today? People a lot of times call me the flipping preacher. It isn't because I do flips. It's because I go from one scripture to another, and I've written some things down, and you might not be able to keep up with everything that I give you, but if you'll just write up those scriptures, I just want to make sure that I deliver completely what the Lord has laid on my heart today. The title of this message this morning is Living Your Life for the Will of God. Living your life for the will of God. And a lot of the things that the brothers testified, and I believe this is true, and God speaks this to me every time I drive into South Carolina from Georgia, and I drive in, just hit Anderson, and just found out a couple weeks ago when I came to visit that pastors actually live in that area. And every time I enter into Anderson, God says, I'm about something. And I move into Greenville, and I'm about something. When I get over here, the Lord says, I'm already doing something. Amen? And so I love to be where God is. I love to be in the places that God moves and the way the Lord dwells. And I believe that we're entering into one of the greatest times that will ever be. The Bible called from the time that Jesus came, the culmination of all time. So we are already entered in from the moment Jesus came. We entered into that culmination of the end of times. How much more we are in the end of times. And unfortunately today the church has fallen asleep in a lot of places, and the blood is never talked about anymore, and the name of Jesus isn't exalted the way it should be, and about the coming of the Lord the church has been silent. But the Bible says he who has this hope in him will purify himself. So we have to get to that place where we recognize that Jesus is coming again. He's coming and the time is very short. And there's a moving that's going on. There's a shifting that's going on. And what's laid upon my heart so much recently is about the moments and the movements of God and about the seasons of God and about how do I get myself in position for the season that God has for me. You see, we want to talk about destiny. We want to talk about the this is that. We want to talk about the it factor, but before we can ever get to those things, we must understand that Jesus showed us how to walk this thing out. He gave us an example. He was the first one to give us that legacy. And I want to share, first of all, in your Bibles, if you'll turn there to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26. Like I said, I'm going to go quickly through these scriptures, but I want you to hear the words of the Lord because it is the word that will bring you life. Amen. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26 through 28. Otherwise, Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world. But Christ has appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages. You see, there are many ages. God's an eternal God with eternal plans and eternal purposes. This is not all there has ever been. This is not all there will ever be. God is a God of eternal ages. And so when Jesus came, it says there in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26, that he appeared at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Just as people are destined to die once and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many. And he will appear a second time. Not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. My question to you this morning, first of all, is are you waiting for him? Yeah. Are you living in a waiting position? Are you living in an expectancy of the coming of the Lord? In 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 through 22, 1 Peter 3, 18 through 22, says, "For Christ also suffered once for sin, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body and made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made a proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism. That now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into the heavens and is at the right hand with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him." I don't know about you, but that excites me this morning to know that it's in him I live. It's in him I move, and it's in him I have my being. There is nothing that God has forgotten about you. He's not forgotten your name. In fact, the Bible says he called you by your name. You see, my mother thought she named me after Dick Tracy. My father had eight brothers. There were no daughters in the family. My mother didn't expect to have a girl, and out I came. And my mother waited 2 days to name me. But I want you to know something. Before the foundations of the world, God called my name. And my name is Tracy. And my name means diligent harvester. And my name means just reward. I was not named after Dick Tracy. I was named by the Father God before the foundations of the world. And at the right time, he chose when this spirit being would leave heaven, enter a physical body, and do the will of God. Amen. We all have, our days are all numbered. Do you know not one of us in this room knows how many days we've got? Only 4 or 5 weeks ago, Jerry called me from school saying she was sick in her body and she needed to go home and rest. I picked her up. She went, I said, "What's wrong, Jerry? Maybe you're just tired." You know, we talked a little bit. And I said, "Jerry, you've got to take it easy. You've got to slow down. You're working full time. You're going to school full time. You need to make sure you balance your life. And so today, just go in there, go in the bed." So she went in the bedroom, laid down. I was walking back out to my van, and the Holy Spirit said, "You go in there right now, and you pray for her." I said, "Okay, Lord." I don't ignore the voice of God in those things anymore, because it could cost someone their life. And so I turned around. I said, Jerry, I know this is kind of unusual, but the Lord said I need to pray for you right now. And we grabbed hands. I began to pray, and she began to weep, and the Spirit of God came in that room. Jerry went to sleep, took a nap, and when she got up, she had had a stroke. But she might not have ever got up from that nap had we not prayed. Amen. See, the Bible says that there are weapons that are going to form against you, but those weapons will not prosper. Amen. Why? Because of Christ. Because of the righteous one, because of the anointed one and his anointing, there is no weapon that is formed against the people of God that is able to prosper. It's finished. Jesus already won. Hallelujah. Ooh, glory to God. Listen to this verse in 1 Peter 4, 1 and 2. Therefore, since Christ suffered in the body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude. See, we don't want to suffer. We don't want to go through hard times. But I'm telling you, if you're going to do the will of God in your life, you're going to fulfill your destiny, there are some preliminary things that have to be done. And Jesus began setting that example for us, and it says that we should have that same attitude because he who suffers in the body is done with sin. So that tells you that when you obey God, your body doesn't like it. When you choose to live holy, your body, that unregenerated part of you, isn't going to be happy about it. You're going to suffer something to do the will of God. You're going to suffer the opinion of another person. You're going to suffer not being able to be the life of the party. You're going to suffer something in your body in order to follow the will of the Lord. Amen. To be blessed and to be able to work, you're going to be suffering your body. You might not want to get out of bed. Amen. So we have to understand to have that same attitude. Verse 2, as a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. See, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 says that in God, or there is in everything a season. Everything a season. Everything under heaven, there's a season. That word season means a session of planting. So we think about the season as a thing we've entered into. No, the season is the time we plant for what the Lord has. And we have to get to that place where we begin to be faithful in the season. What season are you in this morning? What season regarding the will of God for your life do you find yourself in? It's a season, or it's a time for you to plant something. It's a time for you to tear down something. It's a time for you to uproot something. It's a time for you to mourn. It's a time for you to rejoice. Read Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and you'll understand about the seasons of planting. They're all different kinds of ways we plant, but we are planting, we are preparing, we are doing a preliminary work for the visitation of a holy God. Amen. Amen. Help us, Jesus. So there are preliminary steps that we have to take to enter or that precede a season. We just want the season, don't we? We just want the blessing. We just want the favor of God. We just want our destiny to be revealed. I've been walking this thing out with Jesus for 39 years now. And I have seen the Lord fulfill things in my life over a period of the last 30 years. It's not something that happens overnight. See, there's no shortcut to glory. Anybody messed up a few times in life? It's because you began to take on your timetable rather than God's time. And God's time is the best time in your life. But a lot of times we don't want to wait on the things and the promises of God, and they take time. Amen? You think about the little seeds you planted when you were in grade school, and you had the lima beans, and they put that lima bean in a wet paper towel, and boy, the next day, you had a seed, a sprout on that lima bean, but it never grew. And then the teacher would give you another kind of seed and put it in the ground, in the dirt, and you'd be looking over that little pot, and you come back the next day, teacher is still not growing. Oh, she says, no, it's growing, but it's growing underneath the ground. You see, sometimes we don't realize it takes other people to propel us into our destiny. It takes divine appointments, kairos moments, the timings of God and the seasons of God for everything that God has spoken to you to do if you'll be faithful. If you'll be diligent and obedient and allow the movement of God to take place in your life, you will fulfill your destiny. Amen. And fulfill the will of God in your life. Jesus was that example for us. He fulfilled the will of God. Preparation time is not wasted time. A lot of times we don't want to prepare for what's ahead. Have you ever just thought, God, I just want this? And then you got in the middle of it and you weren't prepared. You weren't ready for it and you lost it. Am I the only one? Is there anybody live long enough like me that know that if you would have just been ready for the season, you wouldn't have lost it? If you would have just not been so proud and arrogant, you would have lost it, or you wouldn't have lost it. If you just would have been more wise about how you related to people or what you spoke or what you spent, you might just not have lost it. Amen. Amen. But thank God. You know, I'm in the place of my life where I know I'm entering the last season of my life. This is my last chance. We're in a race against time. We're on a race against time. And I began to study and meditate and think about different people and about their stages of their life and their journey, and heard the mothers and the fathers of old and the generals that have gone on to be with the Lord that we've seen since I've known the Lord. And I've heard their stories and I've thought about it. And almost every one of them gave a testimony, Pastor, of three different seasons in their life. That the first season, they weren't ready. Or God wasn't ready for them and they moved in it. The second season, they weren't ready. And the third season, God and them were in agreement, and they entered into it. I'm in my third season, amen? I'm not going to miss this. Amen, I'm not going to miss this. I know that this is going to take work. It's going to take sacrifice. It's going to take surrender to God. Amen, some of you know what I'm talking about this morning. You're in that third stage of life. You can't afford to miss it. This is your last chance. Amen. Oh, help us, Jesus. But preparation is not wasted time. When you're young, you think, oh, I don't need to do anything. I remember the first time I used to run mile and 2 mile in high school and run track and cross country. And I remember when I wouldn't work out and I think I was going to go run a mile race or run a 2 mile race. And I found out I was slapped out of energy halfway through the race. And I barely made it to the end and embarrassed and humiliated myself. But when I would go out and run my regimen of 6 miles a day and I would begin to prepare myself, then my mind was strong, my body was strong, and I was able to accomplish the goals that I had set. It's the same way in life, amen? Amen. We want to have good families, but we don't want to prepare what it takes to have good families. We want to have good marriages, but we don't want to do the things that it takes to love and be loved, amen? We want good jobs, but we don't want to show up on time, do 110% while everybody else is doing 50% because it just doesn't seem fair. But that's the way we're going to get to where God has for us. Amen. Oh, help us, Jesus. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 5 through 7. I want you to see that Jesus showed us that preparation time is not wasted time. Therefore, when Christ came, Hebrews 10, 5 through 7. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings you were not pleased, and I said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll, I have come to do your will, my God. You see, the Father prepared a body for Jesus to be the Lamb that was already slain, according to Revelation 3, that the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. God, an omnipotent God, an all-knowing God, an all-powerful God, already created and prepared a body for his Son to dwell in to redeem us. Amen. Amen. He already prepared ahead of time for us. In 1 Peter 1, 20 through 21, says he was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times. You see, when Jesus came, it was the beginning of the last times. Yes. revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. So a preparation, I just got to share with you the gospel this morning. I could share with you all kinds of things, but there's no power in it. The power is in the gospel. That God had a dream. That man would be made in his likeness and his image. That he would be created like him. And that he would glorify him in the earth. And he would have power and dominion. And he would rule and reign like he did. And he would have fellowship with this man that he made. But through sin, through Satan's deception, fear and shame and sin entered the earth. But by Christ's substitution, we were set free and we were brought back into relationship, and forgiveness was given and relationship was reborn. Amen. And destiny of God's original dream was given back to us, giving us authority, dignity, and identity. Hallelujah. Through the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
That's the gospel.
Amen.
There is no other gospel. Jesus Christ made a way for us that we could not make in ourselves. He is that atonement for the sins of all mankind. He was made before, the Bible says, the creation of the world. He was created, his body was created in advance for our atonement. Do you know that there are things that have been created in advance for you to walk in? The Bible says there are foreordained works for you to walk in, good works. A book's been written, a book of remembrance, before anything ever came to be, was written about you.
Amen.
God already has it all planned. We think we're making our plans while God is laughing. Amen. The Bible says we can make our plans, but God has the final outcome. How many of you know you made some plans? I made some plans when I was 19 years old, got married. Thought I was going to have the most perfect family. I came from a broken family. My mother divorced 3 times. I lived in a childhood where I never felt a sense of belonging. So when Mr. Wonderful came along, I married him, and I had a dream that his family would be the family I never had. But you see, that wasn't God. That wasn't the way God ordained it. And after 27 years, I lost that marriage. But you know what? God is a restorer. Amen. And so a lot of times we'll disqualify ourselves from things that God wants to do in us simply because we forget the fact that we are human. We are making the best choices we know how to make with the information we have. So some of you need to forgive yourselves this morning that the choices that you made didn't quite work out the way you planned them. I could tell you lots of stories about me. I don't care, because they will bring someone into freedom. Amen. God didn't take me through all the hell I've gone through just for me to say, oh my God, what happened to me? It's how can I help someone else get free? How can I give someone else what God gave me? How can I make someone understand the mercy of a God who loved me in spite of myself? Amen. So we have to understand that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever ask or think. He has made a plan. He has made a plan. And that divine substitution of exchange was made for you and I before the foundations of the world. God didn't say, ooh, let me fix this. Look what they did. It was already planned. Already planned. He already knew our frailty. He already knew the enemy that we were going to come in contact with. He already knew that Satan hated us. Why does Satan hate us? Because we've been redeemed. We have a plan of redemption that he will never have. Amen. So this Son of God became the Son of Man so that the sons of men could become sons of God. The great exchange. You know, in Georgia, they love buffets. I'm so glad that you don't go out and eat at buffets, Pastor. It's like, you know, they just kind of put this whole thing up of all these different kinds of food, you know, and people stuff themselves, and they got to make sure that they get their money. But you know what? Before you go to that buffet, after you get your first plate, they want you to do something. They want you to exchange that dirty plate for a clean one. And so that's what we do when we come to Christ. We are coming to eat at the table of the Lord, but we've got something we're going to have to exchange. We're going to have to exchange our sin and our unworthiness for Christ, who is that clean that clean atonement for our sin. Amen? Thank you, Lord Jesus. The devil knows if we understand the truth of who we are in God, that we can fulfill what God, the will of God for our life. Amen? So he tries to distort it. He tries to keep us away from it. But one thing we've got to understand as people is that God made us for progress. He made us for growth. Those of you that still have hair on your head, look at your hair. It's made for growth. Got to get it cut over and over and over, don't you? Look at your fingernails. God created everything about us for increase. He did not create you for decrease. So anything in your life that's decreasing is not of God. He did not create you for decrease. He created you for increase. He did not create you to stay stagnant. He created you for growth. He did not create you for bondage. He created you for authority and dominion and power. That's who God made you and I to be. He's a God who is seriously intent about growth. Amen? Amen? You see, change is inevitable. None of us look like we did when we were 2 years old. And a lot of us don't look like we did when we were 20 years old. Amen? Amen. You know, I have this saying, and it's oh Lord, can I even remember it? Blessed is the woman who endures temptation, for her back porch will not grow. And blessed is the man who endures temptation, for his front porch will not grow. So there's a lot of changes. Men grow this way, women grow this way. At least in Georgia. Change is inevitable. It's inevitable. We can't get away from change. When we try and not change, we get stuck. And we don't fulfill the will of God, so we become miserable. Yes. And unfortunately, when you're miserable, everyone around you will also be miserable. Yes. It isn't just that if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. If anybody isn't happy and you're around them, ain't nobody happy. Oh, here they come again. Now, have you ever said, come on now, be honest. There are people who have come your way and you say, oh God, here they come again. And you kind of just take a deep breath because you know the only thing coming out of their life, their mouth is marsh. Jesus. It's death. It's disappointment. It's rejection. They need a revelation of who God has called them to be. Amen? So God doesn't want, change is inevitable. We have to embrace the process of change. But here's the other thing that I've learned. Growth is intentional. See, I pastored for 20 years before I began to do missionary work, and then I moved to Georgia from Michigan and started the transitional housing. And I can tell you that in my churches, I've met people who change was happening all the time, but some of them would not grow. See, growth is intentional. The Bible says you have to study to show yourself approved unto God. You want to be used of the Lord, you're going to have to make some preparation for that anointing to be in your life. You're going to have to separate yourself from the things of this world. I can't conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but by the renewing of my mind, I can be transformed with the Word of God. Amen? I got to begin to think different. Change, growth. Amen? Change is inevitable, but growth is intentional. And I just believe that God doesn't connect me with places that are dead. He ain't sending me to dead marshes. Because I won't stick around. I want to be where life is. I want to be where the move of God is. I want to be where the love of God is. Do you know how blessed I am for my daughter to testify? There's so much love here. See, she confirmed to me what I saw. And I just know, Pastor Donnie, this church is in such a place and a position of movement. Of revival, of true revival, because you're a people who have sacrificed much and are willing to wait on God. Amen? And because of that, and that's something that I'm working through right now in a book that I'm writing about movement. And that there are different things that cause movement in our life. How many of you moved in your life because you had to obey something? You had to obey something and then you were able to make a move. You had revelation, like Paul did on the road to Damascus, a visitation, and it moved you into something different, like these young men testified of about this weekend. That caused a movement in their spiritual walk and their closeness, their relationship with God. It caused a movement in a healing of relationships. Amen. I'm trying to hurry because I know y'all have been here a long time. Can you just give me a few more minutes? I want you to receive this word. So movement takes a lot of different things. One thing that we don't want, and it's the very last resort I believe God uses, is persecution. But persecution brings some movement. In the early church, they stayed in Jerusalem, but God's command to them was go to Jerusalem, then Judea and Samaria, and to the other parts of the earth. And because they would not go, persecution had to come to scatter them throughout the world. There are some of you that are experiencing persecution because you haven't been willing to obey. You haven't allowed the visitation of God to move you. You haven't prepared yourself or yielded yourself or submitted yourself to God's will for your life. So now you're in the middle of persecution saying, what's going on? Will it move you? Or will you remain stuck in a place that God never intended you to remain? Amen. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 13:11, Paul said, when I was a child, I spoke like a child. But then I had to put away some childish things. And I had to grow up and I had to be a man. And we have to come to that place where we become that we have to have preparation for that next season. Is anybody else besides me waiting for something that's ahead of you? And you're trying to figure out why it's taking so long. There must be something that you must do to prepare or the season would be here.
Yes.
And God is waiting on us to listen to his voice and ask him, what is it that I need to do to be ready for what is ahead of me? I think about when the Lord called me into transitional housing. See, the Lord sent me to Africa and India and Panama, to some of the most impoverished countries of the world, so I could understand one thing. He took me there to teach me something that I couldn't learn here in America. He had to teach me how the spirit of poverty works and how people bound in the spirit of poverty operate, so that I could come where he's called me with a message of deliverance from the spirit of poverty. But I had to understand how that spirit worked by seeing poverty. You've never seen poverty in America. I don't know how else to say it to you, but you have never seen the depth of poverty that I've seen around the nations of the world. We are blessed beyond measure. Beyond measure. Amen? So that preparation time, we have to make sure that we understand that life is not supposed to stay the same. Amen. Have you met someone whose life's been the same for about 25 years? I don't want to be that person. Life is not supposed to stay the same. God, an eternal God with an eternal plan and purpose, has always been moving. Amen? Jesus left. You see, here's what we have to understand. What you become, say this with me, what I become depends on what I leave. This is the part of the message I want you to really get this morning. What you become depends on what you're willing to leave. You see, Jesus was willing to leave all the glory in heaven and come down and become in the likeness of man. He came down to this earth and he submitted himself to a body, leaving the glory of God. He left the glory to become the substitute for sin. Then he left the earth and went into the lower regions of hell to demolish principalities and powers and make a show of them openly and defeat totally Satan, our enemy. He left the grave and he ascended into heaven to be our high priest, to be our high priest and our king forever, to rule and to reign with dominion and power, and every enemy be under his feet. And his name has been exalted as the greatest, highest name above every name that is named. He had to leave heaven, come to earth, go to the grave, go to heaven, and he's coming down. I want you to know it's not finished. Jesus is coming down, and he's not coming to bear sin. He's coming to bring salvation to all those who are waiting for him. Hallelujah. He showed us that God is a God of movement, that God doesn't want us to stay stuck in one thing or another. You have to make a decision this morning, tomorrow, next week, whenever it is. You have to get to the place that you say, if I want what's ahead of me, there's something I'm going to have to leave behind. You have to leave something to get where God wants you to be. Let me share the scriptures with you about what Jesus has accomplished by us waiting for him. 2 Peter 3. Just give me about 10 more minutes, if you will. 2 Peter 3, 8 through 13. Do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years are like a day. You see, God doesn't see time like you and I do. Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is so patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but that everyone would come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come. It will come like a thief. In other words, there will be people who are not prepared. You see, heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. He will come like a thief to some. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. The earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward. Say forward.
Forward.
To the day of God. Amen. As you look forward to the day of God. And speed, it's coming. Did you know that as you look forward, as you walk forward, as you move forward, the speeding of the Lord comes? The Lord's coming is speeded by our obedience to go forward. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens with fire. The elements will melt like heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. He's coming. He's coming. Amen? He's been moving since the foundations of the world. He was slain before the foundations of the world. He said, Father, send me, I'll go. He came. He lived, and he took sin to Calvary. And then he took that sacrifice that he made to the grave. And he rose up, and he was seated together at the Father on his right hand. And the Father will tell him, Son, go get my church. Hallelujah. And the Bible says if we're ready, we'll be caught up to meet him in the air. Amen. He won't have to come all the way down. Glory, hallelujah. We're going to come up and meet him in the air. Revelation 1, 5 through 8 says that Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and freed us from sin by his blood, has made us to be a kingdom of priests to serve God the Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, and those who pierced him. Oh, I love that. You see, it's not just us who are looking for him to come, but every eye is going to see him, even those who pierced him. All the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. He will say, I am the Alpha and the Omega, who is and who was and who is to come. In Revelation 19, 11 through 13, it says, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like a blazing fire. On his head are many crowns. Yes. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood and the name of the Word of God. And one more verse in Daniel 2:44. During the reign of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed or conquered. It will crush all these kingdoms into nothingness, and it will stand forever. Fulfilling the will of God. What is it you have to leave to get to where God wants to take you? It's not about, see, this is where we get confused. It's not about what we walk away from. It's about what we take with us. Have you ever had to walk away from some things? I've had to walk away from a lot of things recently in my life. Friends, I'm going to share that in a minute. But walking away from things, we can get focused on what we took, what we lost, and what we had to give up, instead of looking at what we took with us. We took with us something greater than what we left behind. Amen? We took knowledge and wisdom of that experience. We took understanding of how to do it differently next time. Amen. We learned that guarding our heart is important, and guarding our life, our words guard our life. We learned the things we should and shouldn't speak. Amen. The men testified of that today. To get where you're going, you have to be ready to leave where you are. I know that this is true of many people in human nature, that we say we want something, but when we're asked to give up something, we say, oh, no, I'm not going to give up that. You will stay where you are. Don't live the same year multiple times and call it a life. I got to say that again, because God's been resonating that in my spirit. Don't live the same thing year multiple times and call it a life. We should not be repeating this year what we did last year. We should not be repeating this week what we did last week. Amen. We should be continuing to get more and more revelation as we seek Him, how to walk out things and promises. Amen. Don't get in that place. Amen. Don't trade God's timing for your deadline. God, if you don't just do this by this time, God's going to do it when He's ready. He doesn't run on our time. Oh, I wish He did. But He does not run on our time. He runs on His. There's a shift going on in the kingdom of God. But in the same point, there's a shift going on in the kingdom of Satan. You think the Antichrist isn't getting set up for everything that he's ready to do? Oh, he's getting set up. I don't have time today because I don't want to keep you any longer. But I'm telling you that the time of the end of the ages is at hand. And there are things. This week alone, Japan had a 7-point-something earthquake. Yesterday, Ecuador had another 7-point-something earthquake. Do you know that there is a magnetic machine that is under the earth, that is at the speed of light? And since that went into full speed in September, all of the crazy atmospheres and weather patterns are changing. And the whole reason for that machine is to penetrate the third heaven. That's the reason the scientists have made it. To penetrate the third heaven. That is called CERN. I don't know if you've ever heard anything about it. It's in the front of this thing that is underground, there is a goddess, an idol built there, and that goddess is the I want to say Shuma, but the goddess is the goddess of destruction. And so these things have been going on in our country, and this is in Switzerland, or in the Swiss area where this is, where this machine is. But this has been a plan. This is something that started years ago, and now it's been restarted. But we don't understand. All these weather patterns, all these different things are changing the whole atmosphere of our earth because man is trying to be God. Nothing different. Nothing different. But we see these things happening and we wonder what's going on. The Bible tells us this will be a sign of His coming. Everybody talking about the blood moons and all these things. This is a sign of His coming. So there's a shift going on. And in this shift, I just want to share this and close with this today. This shift, there are some things you've got to change. Some things you've got to leave behind. S. Social. Your social relationships. Do you have the right people around you for where you're going? Are you around the people who look like your future or the people who look like your past? Social relations is part of the shift. There are people you got to get the gift of goodbye to. The person that calls and drains your energy on all kinds of drama and stupid stuff, you don't have time for that if you want to hear God. Social shifting. Amen. Some of you need to shift off of Facebook because it takes up more of your time than anything else. It's a tool for me of evangelism. I love it. But I keep it in balance, and it doesn't rule me, I rule it. Anything that masters you needs to go from your life. Just a side note there. Social relations shift. H, habits. There's things that have to change. Habits have to change. If we want to get to the place and be positioned for the season that God has, there are habits that have to change. Some of you are going to have to give up some of those same TV series that you've watched for 15 years. Because the Spirit of God wants your attention, but you ain't got time. Habits. Maybe there's something else in your life that has taken the place of what God wants to do in you. Habits. I, the inputted things. Things we input. The things we put before our eyes. The things we put in our ears. Are those things preparing you for the next season of your life, or there's some things you got to get rid of? I'm trying to help somebody this morning, because I don't know about you, but I'm not going to live stuck on a page. I want to continue to move forward in the things of God. F, faith. Faith to trust in God for the unknown. We've got to live in that place. And T, travel. To keep moving forward, we have to stretch ourselves. When you get in your car after church this morning, you can't drive anywhere looking in the rearview mirror. You have to look through the windshield. Some of you need to leave your past behind. It's hindering your marriage. It's hindering your next steps of faith. It's hindering all kinds of things because you won't let go of that thing that happened to you. Let it go, because it's keeping you from your destiny. Amen. God wants us to live in our purpose. He wants us to be strategically positioned. Noah fulfilled the will of God in his life, and he became a restorer of mankind. He fulfilled his purpose. Moses fulfilled his purpose as a deliverer. John the Baptist fulfilled his purpose as a forerunner. David fulfilled his purpose as a king to set up the kingdom that will be eternal. Joseph fulfilled his purpose as being a supplier in the time of famine. Do you know what your purpose is? Do you know why you're here? Don't slow down and surround yourself with those people who look like your future. Amen. There's a preliminary work that's been done. And there's a preliminary work that has to be done in our lives. Many people have to get in a place, see, because we're living in a season, we don't have time. I don't know about you, but I know I'm on a race against time. God didn't promise you tomorrow. He gave you today. And he said, today is the day of salvation. If anyone shall call on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. But there's a preliminary work for salvation. There's a preliminary work for heaven. Do you know what that preliminary work is? The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Salvation is already available, but the preliminary work you've got to do is confess and believe. Amen? It's a preliminary work that must be done. In order for you to obtain what Christ has given you, you must confess him. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. There's no other way for you to receive salvation but through Jesus Christ and his sacrifice at Calvary. Aren't you glad? It's not by works of righteousness that we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Amen. Today's the day The Bible says, while it is still called today. Did you get up and say, this is today? It's still called today. While it is called today, the Bible says, call on the name of the Lord. Would you stand with me? So great a salvation has been given to us. And y'all have been so gracious for me to share this word in fulfilling the will of God. We have to understand there are so many preliminary things that we must do. We must obey Him. We must be faithful to what He has told us. But I believe that there's somebody possibly here this morning that you don't know of a time that you ever asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, come into your life, be your Savior. If you don't remember that time, let me help you. You are not born again. You are not saved. Because it's a divine encounter with God. Going to church does not make you a Christian. Amen. Any more than sitting in McDonald's makes you a Big Mac. Or sitting in your garage makes you a car. Sitting in church does not make you a Christian. The Bible says confession is made unto salvation. So if you're here this morning, you say, Pastor Tracy, I don't know of a time that I ever asked Jesus Christ to be my Lord and my Savior, but while you were sharing the Word of God, something was happening on the inside of me that let me know that I'm separated from God. And today, I don't want to leave here not being sure that my life is hid in Christ and that I'm going to heaven. I need to prepare because heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. Amen? There's no other way but through Jesus Christ the Lord. He died so that you might live. If you're here this morning, you say, I'm not saved, but today I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Will you just lift your hand where you are so I can see you and pray for you? Say, I don't know if I'm going to heaven. If I were to leave here today, pull out of that driveway, get hit by a car, I don't even know if I'm going to heaven. Today I want to be sure. Who is that this morning? Today's your day. Is there anybody this morning? This is the gospel. Jesus made a way for you, a new and living way by His blood. Is there anyone here this morning? You have not yet called on the name of Jesus and you want to give your life to Him. I'm not going to grieve the Holy Spirit. I'm not going to wait any longer, just a minute here. But if you're here and you say, I don't know, I want to be sure. Would you lift your hand? I'm not going to call you forward. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm going to pray for you that you would give your life to Jesus Christ. Is there anyone today? Wonderful Lord, we thank you and we magnify you. Could you just lift up your hearts with your hands right now and magnify the Lord with me? We glorify you, Lord. We exalt you. Maybe you're here today and you've been saved and you've got ankle deep in the water. You're coming to church, but you've not yet received the baptism of the Holy Spirit that belongs to everyone who believes. The Bible says that the same free gift of salvation and the Holy Spirit is another free gift given to everyone who is a believer. If you're a believer and you've not yet received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, today is your day to receive the gift from God. The Bible says if we know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more will the Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? So if you haven't received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I want to open the altar to you right now that you would come forward and we're going to pray for you the way the Bible says. We're going to ask God to fill you. We're going to lay hands on you like the Apostle Paul did. The Holy Spirit's going to come upon you and you by faith are going to begin to speak in a heavenly language and your life will never be the same. There's somebody here this morning, I'm telling you, there's somebody here this morning, you need to get filled with the Holy Ghost. And I don't care if 10, 20 people have prayed for you. I pray for people all over the world. I've seen thousands of people, babies from age three. I've seen people who are mentally retarded receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. People who are 80 years old receive the Holy Ghost. Today's your day. If that's you, you say, I need to be filled with the Holy Ghost, come now. Do not grieve the Spirit of God. You are a believer. You know whether you've been filled or not. If that's you this morning, I want you to come and we're going to pray for you. Who is it that needs to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost this morning? Language. I know that God sent me here because there are people that need His Spirit this morning. So I'm going to be obedient. If you're obedient or not, that's not on me. But somebody needs to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Who is it this morning? Would you come? Holy Spirit, have your way. Anyone here this morning? Thank you, Lord Jesus. This morning the Lord spoke to me that someone is really suffering in the area of arthritis in their body and someone else is having pain in their right shoulder like their rotator cuff. I'm going to pray for those who are sick in their body this morning. Would you come? Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the healer. He is the deliverer. He is the baptizer. He is the salvation source from God. Amen. If you're here this morning, you have sickness in your body. God wants to heal you this morning. Go to Mangatara Bako. So there's someone else. God has placed upon my life some special healing anointing for specific things. And I'm going to tell you what those are. Any kind of organ disease. Look, God's a God of miracles. I said, God is a God of miracles. And he's placed a special healing anointing on my life for people who are suffering from blood disease or any kind of organ disease. I want you to say this. Easy. I said barrenness. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Someone else is having a problem in their right knee. Your right knee. It swells up. It catches. It's in a lot of pain. If that's you, I want you to come to the altar. I'm just waiting on the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. You see, Jesus is the healer. Jesus is the healer. Wonderful, Lord. Just lift your hands to heaven. We're going to pray for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.